looks like it's minus xp. No, I have to pt, I have to minus b plus, minus b minus, and that's what it is, yeah. So I have to do this, and this is equal to k minus p, oh, that's q, because k minus p is just strictly q, and that's an experimentally accessible variable, and then I have to subtract minus k divided by z. But z is a variable that involves, that's momentum fraction. Yeah, but it is also equal to a kinematic variable, so minus z8. This is what I call the experimental. And then plus x Bjorken times b, because x was equal to x Bjorken. Okay, who believes this argument? Did I fool you? This sounds like the things that I'm writing zero when I started with one, eh?
If you have transverse momentum in p q, you have qt, right? Then the plus and minus moment of q cannot be q over square 2.
Let me see. Yeah, but I didn't use this. I just said here the argument was this. This is actually, I didn't fool you. This is correct. Huh? I did do one thing in the last step. Going from here to there, I replaced z by z8. I replaced x by x Bjorken. That's of course not exact. Because x is equal to x Bjorken. I derived it here. But that is throwing away these terms. So this is not exact, but this is true modulo, so this is true modulo, and this also, this is modulo m squared over q squared terms. But the k and the p are order q. So this relation is true up to order 1 over q. And essentially, if you now, I look at the transverse component, that was the QT that I tried to determine, is order 1. So that there are 1 over Q corrections, I don't care. So this is indeed a correct way of defining QT. So the nice thing is that here you have not only P is XP plus PT and some negligible component, we also have QT is Q minus Q plus XP. No, minus XP, what was it? Plus K produced later on divided by Z8. This is invisible for most of the people. But it's actually such an important relation that I should write it here. It's Q, was it minus or plus? Plus X, yeah, okay. B minus k over z. So this is one relation, and the other was essentially the identification of this, where this is equal to x is equal to x Bjorken. So you now have done your transfers also in the case of TMDs, you have done your kinematics. And you have found that kinematics tells you how transverse momentum is linked to the variables. Let me look at that relation a little bit more carefully. Because this is a Lorentz invariant relation. It's the transverse piece of Q. So after defining plus and minus directions, it is fine. And then it's equal to this. Let's do it in two different frames. Qt is equal, let me now write it also here. That is at 3 points, but this is going to disappear at some point. Is Q plus X Bjorken P minus K over Z8. An experimentalist measures this, measures that, with 1 over Q squared corrections. Essentially can construct this thing in whatever frame he likes. In whatever frame he likes, can construct this thing and says, and now I know QT, and this QT is related to not to one particular transverse momentum, but to the transverse momentum essentially of the outgoing jet, outgoing particle minus the transverse momentum of the incoming particle. Let's do this in two different frames. Let me do it in the frame in which Q and P define what is collinear. Then, these don't have transverse directions, and the full transverse direction is in the final state particle. And then the idea is, to measure QT, you essentially see that your outgoing particle is not in the direction that you expect the proton plus the photon momentum to give you. I mean, the proton plus photon momentum gives you, if you want, the direction that the jet should go, x times the proton momentum. No, it goes slightly different. And that difference is essentially the transverse momentum of the produced particle with respect to that collinear direction. But be aware, for a theorist still cannot tell you, oh, that's the transverse momentum in my final state jet. That's not necessarily the case. Because it could also have that the transverse momentum partly is already due to something in the initial state, because the parton was not collinear to the proton. And of course, this you can never determine. Now, there is another frame that you say, let me call collinear the thing that P and the outgoing hadron, those are the collinear directions. That's actually the nice thing that you would naturally do in Drelien. In Drelien, you would say, oh, P1 is my collinear direction and P2, can you define my collinear directions? Then what you will see is, if this and that doesn't have transverse momentum, it's all in Q, it should be in Q. I mean, you cannot put three momenta without transverse directions, that's simply not possible in Minkowski space. So you always, one of them has to have something transverse. Now in Drelien, usually what you do is say, both hadrons, I mean, rather than minus k over z, you would have plus x1 over p plus x2 times p2. Then you say P1 and P2 are collinear, and then QT is really the transverse momentum of Q with respect to P1 and P2. So this is a nice covariant relation which tells you where your transverse momentum is and what your transverse momentum is. So this is the CDIS equivalent, and the QT in the case of Drelien would be minus x1 p1 minus x2 p2, if I'm not mistaken, or plus, okay, whoever, we'll see it in a minute. So that's Drelien. But this is, both of them are covariant relations, but you can use them in whatever you like, as your preferred frame. And that's different for CDIS and Drelien. CDIS you like in a natural way, an experimentalist likes to use the frame in which Q and P are parallel. And then the transverse momentum is in the produced hadron. But for the theoretical analysis, because ultimately now what you are going to do is, you are going to calculate the hard process, you're going to convolute it with this thing and that thing, and then you have to do the D4P, you also have to do the D4K if you have both of these things in there. The K minus is identified with the kinematic variable, that's all in the delta function, because the minus only talks to the Q and not to the P, so that's one part, and then the plus goes to the others, and then the transverse directions are still convoluted, and you always have to do a convolution in transverse momentum, and that's, people know convolutions, what do to get a convolution into a product? Your Fourier transform, and then people Fourier transform to B-space. So that's the whole secret of B-space. You don't want a convolution in transverse momentum, and that's why you go to B-space ultimately.
So experimentally, normally people take in the convention about this Collins-Solberg frame.
Yeah.
And the claim is it will minimize the uncertainty about the unknown about the PT. So I don't know whether this claim is but based on this formula,
I can go from the Collins-Solberg frame to any frame. I mean, I can do that. But the tricky point is indeed that some of the expressions become ugly, and it's of course, I mean, it's experimentally, you can, for instance, there might be a huge difference on determining the relative errors in K and Q as compared to P and K, for instance. That might be much harder than, and so it may be much easier to use one frame over the other. But in principle, I want to maintain that the transverse momentum, or the relevant transverse momentum variable in whatever hard processes you have, has essentially, if you have only two hadrons involved, then these fixes the plus and minus directions if you want. So they fix two scaling variables, xA and xB, and maybe you cannot even, I mean, also in gradient, you cannot get xA and xB. I mean, they still are in a convolution if you want, but in principle, you fix the two scaling variables, and then you have two delta functions left, which fix the transverse momentum. If you have two hadrons and also detect one hadron in the final state, you still have, you have three hadrons involved, so you have three collinear relations, you have three light-like directions if you want, and you still have one transverse direction left. If you have four hadrons involved in a hard process, forget about transverse momentum. There's no way that you can ever determine it anymore. I mean, you have the determination of the hard momenta has an error in it, one over Q squared. And so then you have all exhausted all those directions. You would have to go either to higher orders or say things are more. Forget about that. That, at least as far as I'm concerned, I would not advise you to look at that. But I must say that, for instance, this way of determining the Ex-Bjørken from this, which was done at HERA, of course, I think zillions of theorists knew about it, but they never bothered even to write it down, unless then it proved to be a very useful experimental tool to use the jet direction to get a handle on the Bjørken X also, particularly in certain regimes. But the Collins shoulder frame certainly is one of the very natural ones if you look at this situation. It's actually sort of trying to use the X's, the XA and the XB, to make sure that really the partons determine the plus and the minus direction. And then what is left is truly the transverse momentum of both hadrons. Somewhere it is in there. So it seems very natural. Actually, if you could formally determine the jet direction and identify it with the momentum K, of course you don't need this convolution anymore, because K and K, if you really say I can measure this as a jet direction and that, then of course KT is just KT is K minus K over Z. So if you argue that you can determine K, but that's a jet direction. And of course there are all your jet algorithms and uncertainties in and missing neutral particles and I don't know what is the situation. So I think there is an hadronic size error in that, and so you never, you formally can never do it. But there might be certain situations in which this is possible. But okay, of course, if there are masses involved, if you have heavy quarks or whatever, you have to do this sort of kinematics, including heavy quarks. And then, of course, this cannot be neglected with respect to that. But you know what it is. I mean, it's the charm quark or the bottom quark or whatever that plays a role. And you do this, and you can write down these corrections. Okay, so now my time is more or less up. So I will now summarize, if I can get 5 more minutes. I will say a few things on what I will do tomorrow. Let me see if I... It's maybe dangerous to... Yeah, shall I? I'll do it. I'll show you here what I'm going to do. Without. Choice at some point, so for people who want to read some of this, so summarizing, I mean, this we had last time, we had these cross sections, we had these objects, we had this. I now did this part and explained essentially the various steps. I forgot the last one. If you also integrate, so these integrations going step by step are in fact formal, eh? Because as I said, you cannot even integrate over PT. You can only integrate up to a scale mu, and then you get scale dependence mu squared in this object. While you have to maintain the m dependence here, but that I'll probably leave for technical details for nodes and that sort of thing. So be aware of it, of TMDs. But if you go to higher order 1 over q, sort of m dependence may pop up. So this was what I more or less did in some more detail here, and I think it's not this way better actually than here. So I said as you use phi, and say in some situations, as I'll explain tomorrow, phi is going to be, while this thing would be p slash plus n, a simple form for phi that we'll see is the most general parametrization in the case that there is no polarization at all, is simply this. And m doesn't play a role, so it's essentially p slash times f of p, and it's p. It would be p slash if you had a free quark, and the only modification is a function, and that function, if you are at a level that you have integrated all pt, is the f of x, and it is the Parton distribution function. So it is essentially the unknown function that appears in my correlator phi, if I'm at the integrated level, and at the TMD level. You have the same thing, and then this thing depends on x and pt squared. So that's just a almost what is everything is a simple factor that the thing doesn't depend on x, but also on pt squared. And that's what I'm going to. So these are these hard and which talks to what. And so then essentially you do your calculation, it's a trace, and you get a delta function. I explained that, and what you are left with is your correlator, and you parameterize it. And it is essentially your expression in terms of functions, which are hidden in this parametrization. And the function is essentially going to be 1/2 times the sum over charges squared times the PDFs. It's the well-known expression of structure function W1 expressed in F functions. Of course, you have an F function for each flavor. And for each target, you have different F functions. You have PDFs depending on the flavor type, on the function, etc. And you can play with this structure to get it into a certain form. Some things of this, including the spin dependence, I will discuss tomorrow. So that's what I say is parametrization. What I will probably not talk about tomorrow is essentially how you get the more general parametrization. You use some arguments based on parity, time reversal, etc. But maybe if you say, some of you say, think about it and say, this I want to hear. Maybe look already at the slides and ask me, and then I'll do it explicitly, or I'll do it this evening or this afternoon or tomorrow morning or whatever. Try to find me. And essentially now what you are left with is that if you go to do this thing to the level of pt, you get this function of pt squareds and then that's it. There's the p slash. I now use the capital P because that's an experimental observable, but the x is absorbed if you want in this. This is the proper definition. But then the thing comes. If you also have pt available in the correlator, you, rather than having p slash, you might also have pt slash. And then you have an additional function. And that's the nice thing of having pt, you also get additional new functions. And this happens to be our function. So it's unpolarized, in unpolarized protons. And then tomorrow I'll tell you why this function is representing transversely polarized quarks. This function tells you about unpolarized quarks in a proton. And still you don't need polarization of the target. So where is the polarization of the quarks hidden? Where is the polarization of the target hidden? That's one of the things which I'll tell tomorrow. And then, you know, that's this. So you can can already prepare. You can also do it for gluons. Beautifully, you get circularly polarized gluons, and now you get linearly polarized gluons. Very nice. This I'll probably skip. Yeah, you get some things. Then you start doing more complex processes. This is CIDIS or Draulien. So where you have two of them, that's already what I said here is, this is the variable, so you can find here all the details. The delta function, this is what I did today. So you can measure it. You can even measure it when you have two hadrons coming in and two jets going out. Because these two jets are not necessarily collinear. That's two-to-two process. And in principle, it's still possible to get a transverse momentum, because if you think of two things coming in, if there would be no transverse momentum, these things would be really back-to-back. And they are not always back-to-back. And if you can measure the non-back-to-backness in a jet-jet situation, you have a measure, again, for QT. And since there is now a little bit more involved, you only get one component of the transverse momentum. But nevertheless, since the functions themselves, there's always rotational variance, can only depend on PT squared, some dependence, you can still get the PT dependence of something sound. So it's all hidden in this angle delta phi. So that's this second scale. Large PT, I mentioned it, it's Altarelli Parisi. I did that here in two slides. And then I also will come to the complications that people, I mean, this is from the book of John Collins, it was mentioned already this morning. It's the Bible also for TMD lovers. So it's, I mean, these functions, there are TMDs hidden in these things. There are soft pieces hidden if you really want to do the QCD. And I mean, you find the history of quantum chromodynamics, and, but you don't find the introduction to letters, I think. Eh? That's in there, but QCD is in there. So that's indeed, I also refer to this book for people who want to know it. And TMDs are the last chapter in the book, and it's the unfinished chapter, so keep that in mind. I mean, it also has, I think John will also immediately admit this, that's an unfinished chapter. There are so many open points, and that's not only because we also have gluons, you know. And you know that if you have two psi's sitting here, that you need something in between, so you need this gate string. That's one of the hard complications. And if this thing is not on a line, and a straight line, but it has both longitudinal, collinear, and transverse directions, your Wilson line that connects the two fields is necessarily has to deviate from the light-like direction. So you cannot gauge it away anymore. So it has physical consequences. And that's precisely what is the difference between plus and minus gauge strings. So I'll try to indicate a little bit of those complications that come in, how these gauge links and how they, you need to see beautiful gauge links, you have to do some calculation, beautiful gluon gauge links, you can play with it. I'll give you some feeling for that tomorrow, because I cannot be complete, but I'll try to give you a feeling, why do you need them, and then you sit down and do all the things and get them. So then, of course, if you really want to do things like Draulien, and we'll hear about that in a minute, you have to be aware that there are gauge links in this process floating around, that the two fields here will feel the color of this thing and that thing, so they will, the gauge lines will start feeling things or in the whole process. And that's precisely because transverse momentum, this and that cannot be separated. So even the color here can feel if the color goes into the final state or came from the initial state. So it feels, you need a different correlator. And the correlator has a gauge link either this way or that way. And for some functions, that means a minus sign. That's simply what it boils down to. And for these more complex processes, it means vectors. Nc squared over I don't know what. I mean, there's but all calculable factors, that's the beauty. Quite a lot of things are calculable. And for poor experimentalists, I think they are also measurable, but there I admittedly sometimes pity. I mean, it's tricky. And
but in any case, we have to be very optimistic.
You have to be optimistic. And I think, and that's what I always like is then suddenly I get questions, and I mean, say, can we do it this way? And then it suddenly turns out that you simply overlook things, like say, yeah, there are particular frames, or in this case, this we can measure accurately, but if you do it that way, you can never measure it. And that's things that theorists don't realize. I mean, they struggle with their factors and their minus signs. So I think that the interaction is also very important. Okay, let me leave it at this point and continue tomorrow. Okay, thanks. And I still was speaking too fast, I guess. Yesterday at dinner we were discussing that I was speaking far too fast. Eh?
You were making
a remark, but it doesn't matter. I still am speaking too fast. Questions?
Yes. You mentioned that if the gauge link is on a Lycom, then you can engage with the
work. Yeah. John Collins will be very unhappy because he says the Lycom gauge is, and many people say the Lycom gauge is of course, has its own problems of singularities and that sort of things. But see, if you have the AMU fields, one component can be set to zero. And if you set a gauge link is e to the I integral spatial separation multiplied with the A. If the spatial separation, like in this case, is only in one direction along the light cone, it's either the minus or the plus direction, it's a light cone direction, and then you have only one component of the A field left to get a nice straight line. And then you have your gauge link, and it involves one component, but one component you can get rid of in the A field. And then you still have your transverse components left, and it's fine. But now you have to go along the light cone, but you also have to go out of the collinear direction. So you also need the transverse component. So you see, you cannot gauge it away. And people say, okay, you don't necessarily like the light cone gauge, so maybe you don't want to gauge it away. No, certainly you don't want to gauge it away, because the object as written here on the blackboard was in a sense that was already, you said it yesterday, who's going to make the remark. The object by itself is not gauge invariant because it misses the gauge link. But then I said, yeah, it's the gauge link along a line, and so we gauge it away, and we set it one. But formally in the expression, it is there. I mean, it's an operator, it's a quantum field. I mean, that you are able to, in quantum fields, to take one component where you can set it to zero, or act it on the Hilbert space in such a way that acting on the states gives you zero or whatever. You can do some of these things. I mean, you have to always worry about these formalities, etc. And in quantum field theory, if you go beyond this level, I mean, this is all three levels, sort of parametrization. If you go beyond, again, you have to realize that you have to be careful that the basic objects, just like non-iterable, have infinities intrinsically in them, which have to be subtracted and dealt with carefully in regularized expressions. Then I liked your remark. QCD is the limit of, because then you have regularized things.
Yeah. Actually, I have one copy of Collins' book, and I bought the book from Wenzhen. So if you check the Academic Seneca library, you will not find it because that book is my hand. So tomorrow I should just take that book and just go around to you see. Yeah, I did the last chapter. Actually, I tried to study that in the summer, but I found that it really takes some effort to study. So, but that's challenging.
Can you now switch off the microphone and I'll tell you something?
Okay, sure.
No, then you have to switch off the microphone.
Just come apart.